My attention and curiosity were early drawn to Inishowen, for my own father was a Donegal man. Inishowen, from the great farms of the Laggan to the bleak rocks of Mallin and Slievesnacht, is the most northerly part of Ireland. For thousands of years since the first Neolithic farmers arrived on its shores, families like the Toys of Quigley's Point have kept mountainy sheep for their meat and wool. They keep a flock of predominantly Scots black and speckled-faced sheep, which are brought off the mountain in mid-June for shearing before the heat of the summer. A scene which has changed little over the centuries, even the design of the shears. Similar examples were found during the excavations of Viking Dublin, dating from medieval times. Hugh Toy keeps back some of the wool for the family's use. The earliest method devised for spinning was the distaff for holding the wool and the spindle. This is still in use in many parts of the world today, particularly among nomadic peoples. And this was followed later in Ireland by the great wheel in Irish, Tuirne Mór, which was probably introduced during the 14th century. It was also known as the walking wheel, as the spinster walked backwards and forwards as she spun. The great wheel in Kerry was slightly smaller. The legs were shorter, and the spinster was able to sit and spin. The treadle or low wheel was introduced into Ireland in the 1630s by Sir Thomas Wentworth, then Lord Deputy of Ireland, for the spinning of flax. He also brought over craftsmen from Holland to teach the Irish woodworkers how to make the wheel. The people of Donegal quickly discovered this flax wheel could also be used for the spinning of wool, and this gave rise to the very important homespun tweed industry during the 19th century. The Second World War created a further boom in the tweed industry. There was an increased demand for the heavier, utilitarian fabrics. In order to control the quality and evenness of their yarn, McGee's of Donegal Town had a team of hand spinners. This meant that more spinning wheels had to be made. Mrs. Mary Toy is one of the last traditional hand spinners who have spun wool for their family's needs all their lives. Her treadle wheel has been handed down from mother to daughter through five generations. It was a wedding present to her great-great-great-grandmother, and even then was known to be second-hand. It is believed to be at least 270 years old, and so could have been one of the original flax wheels made by Irish craftsmen and distributed by the linen manufacturers of Ulster during the 18th century. Mary's socks are in great demand, as far away as America. Her family have always walked the mountains dry-shod and in comfort. Cairn Dona, or Cairn, to the local people, stands on the crossroads to Mallin Head, an ancient Christian place as the cross of St. Patrick testifies. Our Our concern here in Chardona at the moment is not just with history, but with an object both of art and of utility, made with great skill and used with great skill, yet going back into a pre-Christian antiquity. James Shields, the last of the traditional spinning wheel makers, his wife Kathleen, and one of their grandchildren. James' father was a cooper and spinning wheel maker whose workshop was the spacious cellar area under the house in Bridge Street. James now keeps his timber there. His workshop runs down one side of the yard at the back of the house.
Hey, Clara, give a hand.
James is helped by his youngest son, Charlie, who is also his apprentice. They make the treadle, or low Irish wheel, which, because of its popularity and widespread use in this county, is also known as the Donegal wheel. The stock, or stool, is the only part of the wheel which is not turned on a lathe and forms the base for all those other parts. An opening is mortised through the stock which will hold the rose and tension screw, as we shall see. Now, this is James's principal wood-turning lathe. Attachments like this router can be speedily mounted on it. A set square has holes drilled through the metal to indicate the exact position of the legs, for all James's tools are adapted to suit his spinning wheel making. A jig ensures that the holes for the legs are drilled at the correct angles. Wood that is used for the legs has the corners removed for ease of turning.
There you are. Enough there.
It's gone, thanks.
A vitally important part of turning is the centering of the timber. A piece of wood revolving off center creates tremendous vibration and is difficult and uneven to turn. A large half-round gouge is used for the rough turning, removing the surplus wood and turning the piece into a cylinder. Charlie uses a template to indicate where the decorative bobbins are to be turned. This is a long-cornered or skew chisel used for cutting in on the design and paring clean surfaces. The gouges must also be presented to the timber so they are cutting the wood efficiently, throwing off good shavings. In scraping, the tool is held at right angles to the timber. The rest acts as a support and helps to maintain the cutting angle of the tool. The spinning wheels can be made from a variety of timbers, including softwoods. Mahogany is used for this wheel. James prefers to use the same timber throughout a wheel, for, as he says, it matches up better. He is also conscious of the devastation being wrought on the rainforest of the world, and has recently been using recycled yellow pine and pitch pine Beautiful timber, as he says himself, some of it well over 100 years old, as sound as the day it went into the building. Many wood turners use a handful of shavings instead of sandpaper. A combined stain and sanding sealer darkens the timber, and a quick drying lacquer is then applied. It takes 50 hours to make a spinning wheel, which is not so surprising when one considers all the turning, sanding, and staining involved, and the number of small moving parts. Charlie is the third generation of the Shields family to make spinning wheels. James's father was a part-time spinning wheel maker, also working as a cooper, making butts for gathering milk, dashed churns, noggins, and piggins. These are the stanners, or pillars, used to support the wheel itself. The footboard or treadle supplies the drive to the wheel through the jinking string or pitman. During the Second World War, James's father made spinning wheels on a full-time basis. The war also provided a new source of materials for the spinning wheels. Convoys of ships rounding Malinhead were frequently torpedoed by German submarines, and their cargoes, which were often timber, and the wooden parts of the ships themselves, were washed ashore. James well remembers walking the beaches with his father around the Isle of Doe and Kilmany, and finding box of fine mahogany and oak, which they brought home and had sawn up.
How you getting on now?
Oh, I'm just going to draw a hole now to the footboard.
Make sure you get them angles there right, you know?
The metal pins embedded in the ends of the treadle shaft are inserted into these holes in the legs to secure it. The actual wheel is made up in doweled and glued rectangular sections before turning. James has made a special clamp which will hold the timber firmly in place until the glue has set, which takes approximately 12 hours, depending on the temperature.
My daughter coming today for this
morning. Thanks. I think it's tomorrow she's coming.
Well, it's ready for her now. Mm-hmm. Nice today.
James Shields' machinery has cost him very, very little indeed. It has come mostly from scrapyards, by his keeping an eagle eye open as to what might be useful and could be easily adapted. Even this bandsaw was picked up for a bargain price. The wheel is secured to a faceplate for turning. James remembers only three professional spinning wheel makers in County Donegal when he was growing up, a man in Glenties, then James Lynch, and his own father, who served as time to James Lynch. Both lived in Carndona. The tool rest of the lathe has been specifically adapted for turning wheels. A check to make sure it is running true. James turns the channels to contain the two separate driving bands. A most crucial moment in the turning. The wheel must be parted from the center section with extreme care to prevent it from flying off while the lathe is turning.
It's just burning the air now.
Now, this is the cranking wheel and spindle for the wheel, not to be confused with the spindle for the flyer mechanism. The spindle is driven through the nave of the wheel before turning. The calipers mark the position for drilling the spoke holes. The carriage maker and the spinning wheel maker share a common terminology: the nave, the center of the wheel, the spokes, and the rim. James remembers being told that wheelwrights also made spinning wheels in County Donegal. The spokes for the wheel are not socketed into the rim like a carriage wheel. They are trimmed at an angle because the rim is slightly dished. And the spokes are held in place by tension and a small metal pin. By holding the handle of the hammer to the wheel, James discovers any distortion in the rim. During the early 1950s, the craft of spinning wheel making had completely died out in Donegal. As James says, you couldn't give one away. He worked as a carpenter in Scotland at that time, and his three brothers still live over there. He began to get the odd occasional request for a spinning wheel. Gradually, the business began to come back. The revival began in earnest about 1968, and soon he was back as a full-time spinning wheel maker.
Hey, I get one, Joe. A few spinners there.
James goes to Mickey McCormick, the local blacksmith, to have the spindles made.
You want some of these gone now straight away?
Ah, if you could.
Great bit last night.
Wasn't out very much.
No, yeah.
Kept going.
Mind
your eyes now.
The spindle is constructed of a length of round, solid steel, a washer, and a short length of tubular steel through which the yarn will pass as it is spun. The various parts of the flyer mechanism are mounted on the spindle, such as the flyer, bobbin, and spindle whirl. The whirl has already been mounted on the spindle and turned. The metal parts are filed down and sanded, so no rough particles remain that could snag the spinning wool. This is the bobbin for holding the spun yarn. A separate driving band will pass around its grooved end. The flyer is the U-shaped piece of wood that distributes the yarn onto the bobbin. The design for the flyer and bobbin mechanism may have evolved from silk spinning, but Leonardo da Vinci is often credited with its invention, although his design does not appear to have been put into practical use. In 1530, some 12 years after Leonardo's death, a German woodcarver called Johann Jürgen perfected the design, and this is the design that James Shields uses for his spinning wheel. The flyer, or heck, as it is known in County Donegal, must be firmly wedged onto the spindle and trued, or it will, like the wood on the lathe, spin off centre and create vibration. The bobbin is slipped onto the spindle, and next the spindle whirl, which is screwed anti-clockwise onto the threaded spindle, so that when driven clockwise, the whirl will not unwind. Now, these hooks on the opposite side of the flyer, or heck, help to distribute the yarn onto the bobbin. The bearings are made from heavy sole leather. These support the flyer mechanism between the small pillars or stanners. This is not a giant pencil sharpener, though it works roughly on the same principle. The tension screw passes through the rows. This screw allows the tension of the driving bands to be adjusted. The flyer unit, made up of the mother of all, the small pillars and the flyer. James plies the woolen driving bands, which have been spun by his wife Kathleen, a scene reminiscent of a harness maker preparing his own thread. Did you ever wonder, James, what was the origin of the word spinster? A spinster, as we would understand the word today, is an unmarried woman. Long ago, a woman was considered unfit for marriage until she had spun the yarn for a set of personal and household linen. And while undertaking this, she was known as a spinster. So the poor woman who did not get her man continued a spinster. James makes his spinning wheels to be dismantled and sent through the post. He sends them to all parts of Ireland and even as far away as Europe and America. James makes carders for sale, as well as spinning wheels, for, as the old song goes, you can't have one without the other. Now, the purpose of carding is to lay the wool fibres parallel to one another, so they twist together to form the yarn. Kathleen's wheel has, by tradition, two driving bands independent of each other. One drives the spindle and flyer, and the other the bobbin. The spinning wheel is said to be bobbin-led because the bobbin spins faster than the spindle to gather the wool. James is perhaps one of the last traditional spinning wheel makers. Or is he? Hopefully young Charlie will continue the craft and the family tradition.